Hello and welcome to The Vote with me, Frank Leduc, and my guest today, Maria Caulfield, who is the MP for Lewis. And Maria, welcome to the programme and thanks for joining us. When I first met you, you were a councillor in Brighton, and unusually for a Conservative, you represented Molscombe and Bevendine, which is a safe Labour ward. You then stood for Parliament in Lewis, which had become a safe Lib Dem seat, and again surprised people by winning there. I said surprised some people, I'm sure, by winning there. And you didn't go to Eton or Oxford. How on earth did you become an MP?
Well, you know, a few people say to me, how did you get into politics? Because I worked as a full-time as a nurse right up until the election in May 2015. Wow. And I got into politics locally as when I was working at the county, the Royal Sussex County here in Brighton. And part of that trust is the Princess Royal in Haywards Heath, which was under threat of closure at the time. And I joined the local Conservatives who were campaigning to save the PRH.
This was about 10 years, 11
years
ago?
Yes, yeah, it was a little while ago now. And the thing with politics is, once you get involved in one local campaign, there's always another one coming up. And before you know it, you're, you know, an activist, really. And so when they said to me, would you like to stand for the council in your local area? Molscombe was, I'd lived there for quite a while. I'd just moved out of the area before the local elections. And so I said, yes, yeah, you know, why not?
I mean, people must have thought you're mad because it was a safe Labour seat, 2007, there's a Labour government. You know, I mean, did you think you had a cat's chance in hell of getting in?
Well, for me, it wasn't just about winning the election, it was about making a difference. And there were some key local issues at that time. One was the school's admission system, which really affected Molscombe because they'd made Falmer High School, as it was then, the only people who could go to that school were from Molscombe and Bevendine. And parents wanted a choice. So parents in that area were very, very upset about that.
Funny enough, that issue, what goes round comes round, that's become
absolutely
a live issue again.
Yeah, no, absolutely. And so I campaigned on that. And then there was also the issue of the Amex Stadium.
Yes.
Local people really wanted that. And obviously the Lib Dems, Norman Baker then in Lewis, which is just at the border there, was campaigning actively against it. And I knew what a big opportunity it would be for that local area to have the home of Brighton and Hove Albion right there. So I was very happy to support residents with that. And there was a number of issues. You know, the council then were trying to sell off the council housing stock. I said I'd support residents in that. So for me, it wasn't about winning elections. It was about campaigning on key issues.
It seems funny as well, actually, because some of these issues, they seem almost counterintuitive. You know, people, if you said today, well, it was the Labour government that was trying to close a hospital down here. It was the Labour government, the Labour council that was trying to sell off all the council houses. People would scratch their heads and say, no, you sure you don't mean it was the other way around? In terms of some people's stereotypes of how politics goes. But I guess each party, when it's in office, faces the difficult decisions about how you deal with housing stock that needs a lot of money spent on it to bring it up to scratch. The challenges of where we provide healthcare and hospitals, etc. And they're no different whichever.
Yeah, absolutely. I think you've always got an advantage when you're in opposition that you can say what you're against, but the trick is to say what you're also for if you were given the opportunity to be in government, whether it's local government or national government. And, you know, governments of all shapes and sizes have to make tough choices and sometimes often unpopular choices. And that is the role of government. And so, you know, I was very much, you know, campaigning on issues when the Conservatives locally and nationally were in opposition. And now we're in government, we are having to make tough choices. But I'm not afraid to stand up as a backbencher to the government, for example, when we're making, you know, sometimes when I think we're not making the right choice in government, and to say, hang on a minute, let's think about this.
It's very hard, isn't it? Because I think with all the political parties, and again, I mean, you know, Labour are probably showing some of the cracks at the moment and the difficulties that come when you're not united. But equally, you know, while divided parties rarely win elections, when you're, you know, if you think your party leadership's going the wrong way, you've got that difficult decision between, are you loyal or do you challenge? And if you do challenge, do you do it publicly, vocally, so your constituents know you're speaking up, if you like, or do you do it discreetly and behind the scenes? And I know different people have different preferences. And sometimes different party leaders probably have different preferences about how they're approached as well and challenged, and how easy or difficult it makes them to think again about things. I mean, you've been particularly vocal, I think, about the trains locally. We've had one or two delays, I think it's fair to say, over the past year. I mean, even last... Well, we're recording this, I should say, we're recording this on a Monday morning, the morning after the Brighton Marathon, when, you know, and the scenes at Brighton Station last night, well, they were as crowded as the seafront was during the event itself at times, it seemed. what do you, I mean, are you and your colleagues, because Sussex is mostly Conservative MPs.
Yeah.
Are you able to make a difference on this issue?
Absolutely. And I think, for me, it's a shame where the Labour Party is at the moment, because a government needs a good opposition to really kind of keep its feet to the fire in terms of the decisions it's making. And if you don't have a good opposition, you can become complacent and not make the decisions you would if you had someone challenging you. Yes. And really critically looking at what you're doing. So I think as a backbencher, and because we don't have a big majority, as backbenchers we have quite a lot of power, because if we aren't going to support something, it's unlikely to go through. So I like to think of myself as a critical friend to the government. You know, obviously I support the government, I sit on a Conservative manifesto, but, you know, I'm also there for my constituents. And if I think that something's not going quite right, you know, I won't be afraid to say it. And I have, as you say, spoke out very strongly about the Southern Rail issue and was very vocal on that. And that didn't always make me popular necessarily in the Whip's office, but...
And the Whip's office, these are the people who basically manage The troops, as it were, the parliamentary.
Absolutely,
troops.
And you're right, you know, you've got to be united as a party, and if you've got to make difficult decisions, you know, you've signed up as a Conservative and you've got to support the government and do that in a united way. But actually, you do also sometimes need to go and say, well, there's another way of doing this. And we do a lot of that behind the closed doors, and that's the way to
I'm
do
guessing
it.
It must take quite a big issue like Southern, where it has been a long and continuing problem. For people to sort of, I don't say break ranks, but to speak out publicly. And also, do the Whips cut you some slack, if you like, knowing that this is, in some respects, a local, if I said a local issue, I appreciate it affects a hell of a lot of people between here and London and, you know, and many, many constituencies. But it's a sort of relatively, it's not a national issue as such. And therefore, presumably, you've got a bit more license to sort of be seen to be speaking up or be heard to be speaking up for your constituents.
But also, I think, you know, certainly the Whips, the Whips that I deal with are very, they actually want to hear what's being said out there in the real world.
Yes.
And things like the grammar school, there was a proposal when David Cameron was still Prime Minister to turn all schools into academies.
Yes.
Now, I'm not against academies. In fact, when I was the councillor in Molescombe, we turned Falmer High School into an academy, and I think they can do a great job. But I don't think schools should be forced to become academies. If that's what they want to do, if the parents and the teachers and the students are behind that, great.
Yes.
But I'm not there to say that every school must be an academy. And there was enough of us then to say, look, we can't support this. But we did that behind closed doors. We spoke to the ministers and the policy was not pushed ahead with. And it's similar. We've got an issue with schools funding at the moment.
Yes.
So that doesn't necessarily affect Brighton and Hove so much, because their settlement is not too bad. But in East Sussex, we've got one of the worst settlements in the country, and for small rural schools in my constituency, they are really going to struggle with that. And so I've taken my head teachers up to see the minister, I've made representation to the Secretary of State, and we're hopeful that we'll get that the school funding issue re-looked at.
It's a challenging thing as well, because, you know, again, some of the issues that you deal with in politics are sort of, you know, very headline grabbing, if you like, very, you know, the people get their teeth into things like bombing Syria or stuff like this. But this is like the nitty gritty of financial formulas and stuff like that. It's very sort of detailed, dull, you know, and quite sort of technical in many respects.
Yeah.
And yet it has a huge impact on people's
lives.
It
does. And it can be detailed and dull. But when you look at the impact of that, then that's when, you know, you can see that it makes a difference to people's lives. So, you know, I'm not afraid to say, actually, you know, in East Sussex, in my constituency, my head teachers, my parents are concerned about these changes. And if they go ahead, they will have a big impact. You know, I think that's important as a constituency MP, is to highlight that, because my short time being an MP since 2015, you do see a London-centric view of the world when you're in Westminster. And very often it's my responsibility to say, whether it's to the Whips, to the ministers, to say, well, back out in Sussex, this isn't, it might work in London, but it's not going to work here. And that's my responsibility. You know, if I just went along and said everything was rosy to the government, then I think that's when they become complacent. When they've got MPs who are saying, actually, you know, a bit like the National Insurance changes that were announced in the budget, actually in the real world that's going to cause a bit of an issue. I think they like that, and they are responsive, and I think a listening government isn't afraid to change direction if they think they've not got it
quite right.
It's funny
when Margaret Thatcher was Prime Minister, you know, the famous line was, you know, no U-turns, but actually if you look at how she governed, she listened a lot more than probably people ever imagined, and she did tack and trim quite a bit, and indeed U-turn, and I think probably very sensibly. I wanted to take another on another train journey, BML2, and We've got about a minute before the break, but this second Brighton Main Line, is it ever going to happen, do you think?
I think it's got the best chance ever of happening. And the Brighton Main Line will be a second rail main line from Sussex, including Brighton, up to London and reopen the Lewes to Uckfield line. And we've got outside contract, an outside consortium who are very keen to make this happen.
They've got money, they've got ideas, they've got connections.
And they've got the ability to project manage it as well, okay. Which is key.
And that would go Brighton, Lewes, Uckfield, Tunbridge.
Yeah,
and then
past Croydon and then out to Canary Wharf.
So it wouldn't get caught up in that logjam, because on the Brighton to Victoria route, Croydon's the real logjam, isn't it? East Croydon. Listen, we're going to take a break for the ads in a minute, but please don't go away. There's loads more I want to ask you, and including... Well, let's just watch these ads. See you in a few moments. Hello and welcome back to The Vote with me, Frank LeDuc, and my guest today, the MP, Maria Caulfield, who represents Lewes. I wanted to ask you as well about what it's like being an MP, because as you said, you worked until 2015, right up to the election, as a nurse.
Yep.
Very different jobs?
They're not too different, actually. I mean, certainly from a constituency point of view, because as a nurse, you're there, and I worked in the field of cancer care, you're there with patients and relatives who are facing difficult times, sometimes the most stressful periods of their lives. And very often they will take that out on you, they'll be angry, not with you personally, but with the situation. And politics isn't too dissimilar. On a constituency level, I'm there to help people who may have housing issues, debt issues, immigration issues, who are very anxious about what's happening, who can get very angry about what's happening, but it's not directed at you personally, it's about the situation. And you know, your job is to work on their behalf and to resolve their issues if you can. And sometimes you've got good news for them and sometimes you haven't. So it's not too dissimilar in terms of looking after people.
And in terms of being a councillor and being an MP, is there much of a, would you say there's much of a difference there?
Well, I think as a local councillor, certainly in Brighton and Hove, which is a unitary authority, so you're controlling everything in the city, you've probably actually got more power than a backbench MP. So when I was a councillor, I was cabinet member for housing, so I ran all the council housing stock in the city. And I had a budget of millions of pounds that I was responsible for. As a backbench MP, I have no money. Yeah. And although I vote, my decision isn't the last decision.
You sort of have probably, would it be fair to say you probably have more influence than power? You have
I have more influence than power, but actually locally, your local councillors have a huge decision-making ability and can make a huge difference to the city.
Yeah, I mean, you did all that work on housing when you were down here. I mean, and again, issues that are still being wrestled with, like the student housing in your old ward, Molescombe and Bevendean, and other parts of the city, and the challenges that throws up. Have you sort of kept an interest in housing or in health since you've gone into gone to Westminster?
Yeah, certainly housing I have, and I'm a patron of the local charity Homelink in Lewes, which helps people get a deposit for a flat or a place to live. And I did a few adjournment debates and joined their campaign to try and ban letting agents' fees, because sometimes, certainly in Lewes, people are paying for a 2 months' deposit in advance and then maybe another £1,000 on top of a letting agent's fee. And we really campaigned hard on that, and the Chancellor in the autumn statement last year announced that letting agents would no longer be able to charge those extortionate fees. So we are making a difference. So housing is still a passion of mine, for sure.
I mean, things like that, they must seem, I don't know how many of your fellow MPs were sort of behind the same campaign, but it must be quite a good feeling when you do something like that comes up and you get a result.
Yeah, no, absolutely. And one of the things I'm campaigning for at the moment, I mean, I still work as a nurse, part-time even. I do a couple of shifts a month just to keep my registration up, and it's important to see what's happening. But there are a number of health campaigns that we are working on at the moment. So trying to increase the role of pharmacies, for example, in primary care, so that if you've got a cough or a cold, you go to your pharmacist first rather than your GP.
Take the pressure off GPs.
Take the pressure off GPs, and actually to really appreciate how experienced and well-trained pharmacies are. And pharmacists really want to take this role on, and they really need someone in Parliament who's kind of shouting their corner.
And is this the case that it falls to sort of one or two people, or are you again part of a sort of a number of people who are basically sort of accept this is a good idea, a good policy, and then you're trying to push it forward?
Yeah, so you can champion causes on your own, and that does certainly work. But I always find, particularly on local issues, that if you join forces together as MPs, and the Southern Rail is a good example of that, there was cross-party support about getting that dispute resolved. And if we work together as a, usually East and West Sussex MPs together, actually we can achieve quite a lot.
I mean, is it easy to get on with your political, I think people outside politics just to see the different tribes and don't appreciate that sometimes people do talk to each other, and sometimes even on friendly terms across party lines. I mean, has that been your experience at Westminster? Or?
Yeah, I think once, you know, most people see Prime Minister's questions, which is a bit of a bun fight and lots of shouting and, you know, lots of tribal warfare there. Yeah. But actually when that doesn't happen, most of us are in committees working together on issues. Outside of committees, we're working on campaigns together. And so there's good cross-party working. And I, when I go and visit schools, I describe it sometimes like Hogwarts, that you're all in your different houses. And, you know, when it comes to it, you all want to do a bit better than the other house. But actually, you're really one united parliament and you want the best of the country.
And it's, I mean, one of the things that's interesting about, again, with politicians coming together, we had the awful incident the other week with the guy driving on the bridge and then stabbing a police officer in the grounds of Parliament. Just over a year ago, one of your colleagues from a different party, Joe Cox, was murdered. There's been a lot of talk about how in public life, you know, we've gone from the 60s or the 50s, the age of deference, and the pendulum seems to have swung very much the other way, where people are almost, outspokenly cynical and rude about certain figures in public life. And sometimes it seems particularly women. Or people who are different in any shape, form or size. Have you encountered any of this, or do you get a fairly sort of easy ride?
No, I think I found the one thing I have struggled with since being a nurse, from being one of those professions that everyone loves nurses, and certainly as a cancer nurse, everyone particularly loves, you know, Macmillan nurses, Marie Curie nurses, to going to being an MP where, you know, there's estate agents who are more popular than you, has been quite difficult, because I worked hard as a nurse. I worked long hours, days, nights, weekends. But working as an MP, when people say, oh, you know, you've got your feet up most of the time, or people are asleep in the chamber, actually, I've never worked so hard in all my life. I work 7 days a week, not had a holiday since being elected. I don't want people to get their tissues out. But it isn't an easy life. And the abuse you get from people, you know, locally, nationally as well, is quite hard to take. And, you know, I've had death threats, I've had my tyres slashed, I've had my office graffitied, you know, and in the short space of time of being an MP, I've seen Joe Cox, who was just behind me when we were taking our oath together as new MPs, you know, PC Keith Palmer used to open the gate for me every Monday when I'd go into Parliament. And in 2 years, I've seen two people murdered, you know, been involved in a terrorist attack. So, you know, it's a tough job. I'm not asking for sympathy. It's a job. It's an honour to be an MP. But actually, people are very, very angry sometimes, and they do take it out on you personally. And I just don't understand why there's so much anger in society about, and particularly directed towards MPs.
I mean, I just wonder, because I don't know whether this is just perhaps this is a big sort of philosophical debate for another time, but it just seems Western societies in general seem to be getting more angry at the moment. I don't know whether that's just a wider thing, and you know, politicians and etc. the touchstone, if you like.
And I think social media doesn't help, because people could, you know, in the old days, people used to have to write a letter. I was there in the old days. You had to write a letter and think about what you're saying, and put a stamp on it and make an effort. Now, if you're just angry, you can just fire off a tweet or put a post on Facebook. And very often people don't hide their identity on Twitter or Facebook. So it's very easy to be anonymous. Yeah. And that just generates a storm on Twitter. And I think that gives people permission to be angry, and actually, you know, it's fine to have a different point of view, but there's a way of doing it. Yeah. And I think social media has probably fueled some of that aggression.
It feels as though we've sort of lost respect for people with a different point of view to our own, if you like, and have lost the rules of, you know, decent debate. I mean, yeah, and sometimes people will get heated in debates quite often, so particularly sort of things that really matter, but it seems to be almost all the time about everything.
And I think Brexit really didn't help with that. You know, I voted to leave. I voted to leave, but a lot of my constituency voted to remain. But I think, you know, like you said, it's fine to have a different point of view. My vote was no more or less important. It didn't count anymore just because I was an MP. It was one vote out of everyone else's. But the amount of abuse that I got for that. And I think that the actual debate, whichever side you're on, Remain or Leave, was appalling. You know, neither side gave a good argument, neither side gave facts, and people who were in the middle and wanted to make up their mind were really left with very little to make a judgment. So I don't think that helped the you know, people in the country to kind of, you know, have a grown-up debate about these issues.
As sort of the practicalities of sorting out leaving the European Union dawn now, do you ever sort of, I mean, again, you were saying about the facts not getting in the way of a good debate here, I suppose. do you sit back and think, actually, was this such a good idea? Or do you think, actually, it's one of these things where there are advantages of leaving and disadvantages, and the advantages outweigh the disadvantages, so we must go for it?
Yeah, I mean, I voted to leave. I'm on the Brexit Select Committee, so part of my job now is to scrutinise the government as we move into the negotiations. And while I voted to leave, you know, there are disadvantages to leaving, there's no doubt about that. And, you know, it's important that we make the right decisions now going forward. And things like guaranteeing EU citizens' rights who are living here now, I think absolutely we should be doing that up front. And in the second report of the committee, I voted for that because I think we have the moral high ground. We gave the referendum to the British people, so we owe it to those people who are now in a difficult situation to say, well, actually, you can stay. So I think there are some disadvantages. I'm optimistic we can get a very good deal and that we can do very well leaving the EU. But there are some genuine concerns, and it'd be wrong if we don't address those.
And I guess with, as an MP with Newhaven in your constituency, the Channel Port, I mean, actually, that could benefit from this in some ways.
Absolutely. And ports, you know, are going to have huge potential leaving the EU. And certainly in Newhaven, we have got businesses who want to come and invest in the port. And we're trying to build the infrastructure in terms of road and rail around.
Maybe that will link up with BML too.
Hopefully.
Perhaps we can revisit this another time. Maria, thank you so much for joining us. And
no, thank
I do
you.
Hope you'll come again soon. And please do watch the debate soon. Goodbye for now.